Hey, welcome to FAMA2020 Manta Rapid Review. If you actually been following this, you know what the rules are. I'm not gonna explain it again. Because I've realized stuff happening, I may watch less stuff in my later months. So yeah, but let's get into this list, shall we? First one, Clouds. Man, this has to be the best Disney movie this year. The plot of this movie is like combining I Still Believe and Baby Teeth. Just throw away all the bad qualities of I Still Believe and focus on all the good qualities of Baby Teeth. It is based on a true story, which I don't know about, but after watching it, I want to know more. The first thing I like about it is I just love how the main character, despite he knows one day he will die, he just spent most of his life accomplishing his dreams and just make joy to other people. Finn Argus, Sabrina Carpenter, and Madison Eastman, they are all good in their roles. And I actually really like their relationship of how they help each other during those times. And I actually really like his family as well. His family actually got more depth and more development than what I initially thought. And the song is actually really good. The movie hits me quite a few times. Also, the climax of this movie, I kinda tear up. As for issues, one nitpick. Sometimes just like, yeah, just chill the fuck down, man. I mean, they actually eventually did, but just like, that's kinda necessary. Honestly, the movie just hits me so hard, I just don't really care much about it. The movie just makes me feel so much. My brain may not agree, but I'm gonna listen to my heart for this one. My heart says, Clouds gets a 10 out of 10. Next one, Love and Monsters. Yeah, this movie is good, I like it. Yeah, I like the little Brian. He's good in Teen Wolf, he's good in Maze Runner, and he's good in here as well. I'm actually fully engaged in the second act, and that is easily the best part of the movie for me. I love seeing him meeting different things in his journey to help him. The old man, the little girl, the robot, and the best one here, the dog. The old man, the little girl, and even the dog have something inside them that you can even empathize with them. And I also like how the main character, Joe, is actually a rookie and he sucks at the world, and in the journey, he learns to become better and embrace the new world. Also what to do to survive and kill the monsters as well. But most things are in the second act. The first act is kind of iffy, it has too many exposition, and other characters just didn't act too concerned to Dylan O'Brien's character when he goes to the surface. And the third is just, yeah, I saw it coming. It's such an in-your-face twist. And most of the things in the final battle, it's not that interesting. And it's actually not as good when it's compared to the other monsters come before it. The first and third is not bad, it's just fine. But still, I do think this is a good movie. Mostly because of the second act. Giving it a 7 out of 10. Then, The Craft Legacy.
I'm gonna be honest here, I never watched The Craft. So if anyone could be fair to this movie, it's me. Even that, wow, this movie is such a clusterfuck. But I'm gonna be fair here, let's talk about some good stuff first.
Kaylee Spani is good here, and I do like her relationship with Michelle Monaghan's character.
I do like characterization of the main character, even for the bully as well, surprisingly. In the first act, I was actually engaged because I like to see a main character adapting her new life and how she deals with the people around her. And that's pretty much it. The movie has a lot of negatives, but for the sake of the runtime, I'm just gonna keep all the main points and just dismiss all the minor points. For one, the main character is really passive. Not until the third act, she constantly needs to be told by her friends to just, hey, go there, and then she just say, okay. I'm fine if she has some conflict with them, but just, there's none to begin with. Even when she's finally doing something in the third act, in the final battle, she just gets captured. Spoilers, but I don't care. The movie has multiple twists and turns, but instead of shocking me, I just goes, what? That makes no sense. Besides, why Lily, the main character, has powers, there's no explanation of anything.
And also the main villain, yeah, there is a villain.
He's a stupid, sexist moron who constantly forgot he has his minions and he has powers. And the final thing that I just could not excuse it. For at least half the movie, it's not The Craft, it's basically just a domestic thriller. And the part that has The Craft inside, I guess is only in like the first 40 minutes at most. And I just don't know why. The movie is literally called The Craft and I don't know what is happening behind the scenes. I just don't know what to express about this. So whatever, I'm just gonna rate this movie. It gets a 2.5 out of 10.
Next one, Words on Bathroom Walls. I watched a trailer of this movie and I really love the trailer, so I just checked this movie out. And yeah, this movie is brilliant. Charlie Plummer is good here and I do empathize with his character of having schizophrenia and afraid to open up with people. Taylor Russell is good as his love interest and I do like her character having more depth than I initially thought. Also, Anne Sophie Robb is here. I've seen her in Charlie and Chocolate Factory, Bridge to Terabithia and The Act, which I haven't finished yet. And honestly, her appearance actually steals the show for me. Being one of his imaginations, constantly enjoying life and telling him to do the right thing. And I do really like the scenes of him just dealing with schizophrenia and how it affects his normal life. Also his parents as well, which I actually really like them. And one of them actually has a unique turn which I didn't see coming, which I actually really like about that. Also this movie has four themes at once, which at first I was just like, well, will it work or just doing too much? The themes of you are not alone, trust people, believe in yourself, and have a dream despite what you're facing. And they actually execute all four of them at once perfectly at the end. Much to my surprise, but I still have some things I don't like about that. One, he has three imaginary friends in his head, which I was just like, man, that's too much. Especially one of them is basically useless. For me, it's better to just focus on two of them. Also, some situations I was just like, why don't you just do that? You're making things complicated. Also, for me, the ending is just a bit too happy. I mean, I don't know. I just expect a bit darker instead of just too happy. And yeah, those are all my issues. Also, one thing I really want to talk about is actually the portrayal of mental illness in fiction. Because I heard some people have issues with how they deal with that in this movie. Because it's not realistic. You have to remember that this is still fiction and it's just melodrama. And all you need to do is portray emotionally you're realistic. I mean, sure, you have to still portray how schizophrenia is like, but you can't possibly portray 100% correct. If that is the case, that thing does not exist in fiction. And for me, I think it's actually really well, and I actually want to look into schizophrenia even more, giving it a 9 out of 10.
Then, Rebecca. God, I should admit that I never watched the Alfred Hitchcock version, or even read the book, but even that I still don't understand what is this movie. In the first act, I was actually engaged. I like this cute little love story romance, and I like Lily James, but afterwards, I just don't know what I'm watching. I mean, afterwards, the movie just turned into horror, psychological thriller, and then drama, and then a murder mystery, and then at the end, a Nancy Drew show. Lily James and Kristen Scott Thompson are good in the movie, and Armie Hammer is alright, I guess. The title Rebecca is actually referring to a male lead's dead wife, and everyone loves her because there's a horse that only listens to her, and she is the most beautiful person the person ever saw, I guess. I was here just like, are you sure that you're more beautiful than Cinderella right there? So yeah, I just do not understand why people like Rebecca so much, and also the Rebecca liking stuff is as subtle as a sledgehammer to your face. After the first act, I was just confused, and I just don't know what to say about it anymore. It gets a 3.5 out of 10. Then, Violet Evergarden the movie. This will piss some people off because I just don't like this movie. I can see a good movie inside, it's just, it has all the right pieces but put in all the wrong orders. In the first 30 and 40 minutes, I was just like, what? Why are you recapping everything in the anime beforehand? It's just so boring. I understand you want to do that just in case people don't understand the situation by not watching a TV show beforehand. But afterwards, there's a scene I was just like, why don't you just put that in front of that movie and cut out the first 30-40 minutes? That 5 minutes establishes a character and a situation much better than the first 30 to 40 minutes. And that is one of the examples. I don't have much to say about this movie besides it actually reminds me of one movie, which is actually really similar when you think about it. Both movies feature a female writer who has already moved on with their lives. And both movies, the main character has to go to find a sick girl
and meet the people that they haven't seen for a long time. Also, both movies has a lot of flashbacks, intercut with real life events. But if Violet Evergarden the movie can structure like this for 2019, it would be way better. For me at least. If you like this movie, I'm happy for you. I just think it can be much better.
It gets a 4 out of 10. Then, I'm thinking of Ending Things. It's a really subtle but brilliant movie. Jesse Pellman and Jesse Buckley, who is very, very underrated, is good here. And the dialogue is absolutely fantastic. The movie also has a sense of mystery of, wow, what's going to happen next? And you actually don't know what's going to happen next. And the movie actually has some twists and turns, and then at the end, I was just like, wow, I did not see that coming. But it makes sense.
But even that, I still have things I just don't like. Even though I think the dialogues are brilliant and it actually drives the movie forward, I just don't really like the metaphorical dialogues which is people just talk so vaguely. And sometimes they did, I just like, please move on, I just don't want to hear it. Also, sometimes the lighting is just like, wow, that's really dark, I can't see a thing. Also, sometimes this movie is just like, wow, that's gross! I know this is their intention, but I just think it's just too disturbing for me that I just can't take it. Still a really great film though. Give it an 8.5 out of 10.
Then this movie with a really long name. The movie is fine. The physical comedies all land. I did laugh a few times, but the
word comedies, it's range from fine to just irritating. Also, this movie does have some twists and turns, just like that subvert the casual movie genre trope. And you know what? Sometimes it actually works. The songs are enjoyable, the production is good, and there are some really interesting music video sequences here. But the actors, Rachel McAdams and Will Ferrell, are fine here, but the chemistry with each other is too little. Also, the movie is too long. When this part is finished, and then I check the time, which is like, what, 30 minutes only? And the movie just keeps on going, and because of that, there is so many poorly timed jokes that last too long. Also, the villain is dumb. But anyways, the movie is still fine. But seriously, Will Ferrell needs to stop acting like a man baby in all of his movies. This movie gets a 5.5 out of 10. And the last one. Oh my god. Fuck. Honestly, a lot of people are shit on this movie already. I don't want to add much about this.
Besides, I'm from Hong Kong, so I just get especially offended. Whatever, you see the score already.
Then TV show. First one, the 8 miniseries. I just don't like this. I mean, I think the 8 movie and 8 chapter 2 movie are better than this miniseries. Tim Curry is the best part inside. Yeah, sure, he's not Bill Skarsgård, but he's still really good inside. We do spend more time with the adults outside of Derry's compared to the movies. The adults in the miniseries act slightly smarter than them in the movies. And yeah, that's all I can think of. Honestly, most people only remember this miniseries because of Tim Curry, and I understand why. The acting are hit or miss. The pacing is rush and dragged on at the same time. A lot of things are just so dated and just the situation does not make really a lot of sense. The editing is just shit. Also, for me, 3 hours is just not enough for both parts together. Also, I just don't have a moment I felt frightened for the characters. So yeah, it's pretty bad. I'd rather watch both movies again. Giving the miniseries a 4 out of 10.
Then Unorthodox Dogs. Here's the thing, I love this show but get disappointed at the same time. There are 4 episodes in the show, and the first 3 episodes I was fully engaged. I love seeing her dealing with her new life and escaping her old life because her old life is just shit, with a culture that is utter nonsense. Also, Shira Hess, who plays the main character Esty in the show, perfect casting. You buy the fact that she wanna leave this stupid life, but at the same time, she's not 100% confirmed that does she really want to do this. Also, I just love to see how that stupid culture just shaped her as a person to this day. There are several times that I actually feel really sorry for her and very emotional as well. Especially for seeing that when the person is shaving her hair. It's one of the most well-acted scenes I've seen this year, and it's just an emotional gut punch. Also, there's 2 people finding her, and one of them is her husband. I was like, yeah, I love the fact that he actually has emotional conflict of is he doing the right thing or is she leaving because it's actually good for her, and that is really good stuff. So what's the issue? Well, this is all in the first 3 episodes. In the 4th episode, it's not bad, but it's just disappointing. I seriously believe that it will be work much better if there is 1 more episode, because there are several times I was just like, what, where did that came from? Also, several times I was just like, what's the payoff of that situation? Oh, there's none. And yeah, 4 episodes just makes me feel like the show is just rushed and it just don't know how to end. It's not the Stranger level of bad, but still. It's still a great show, but I just wish that it stuck the landing. It gets an 8 out of 10.
Next, Spinning Out. Okay, Spinning Out get cancelled after season 1. At the end, they have the balls to just leave the climax on season 2. But to be fair, I do understand why they think that they will have season 2, because they got Teresa from Maze Runner and Primrose Everdeen from Hunger Games to star in the role. But if I'm being honest, why the show gets cancelled after season 1 is because the marketing of the show is just shit. So what do I think about the show? Actually, that part takes me some time to figure that out.
Tanya Scolario and Willow Shields are both good in the role. The ice skating scenes are entertaining, and it has good cinematography as well. Even though sometimes I can tell that they put CGI on the actors' faces. I like how the main character Kat is dealing with her career and also suffering from bipolar without anyone noticing. And she's forced to team up with someone she doesn't like. And also her mother, who also suffers from bipolar. I also like to see how her friend actually deals with her own injury because of some skating incidents. I also like her partner, which he learns not to be a dick at the end. I do really like the relationship between the mother and the daughter and the sister and even 3 at the same time. And yeah, those are all I like about the show. Now let me talk about the things that just confuses me. It's really because of the plotting. Season 1 actually takes place for a year, and because of that, a lot of things are just like, wait, where did that happen? Oh, off screen, between episodes. And you can tell that a lot of things actually felt rushed in the show. And sometimes things are just like, well, do you need to actually need to add that thing inside? Like, for example, stealing from a car. And because of that, the payoff, which I mentioned already, they cut the climax, and there's something that was just like, seriously, that's a payoff? Boo. And also, the show just has so many mysteries that being unresolved because they ended only in one season. Overall, I do like the characters and the sequences. It's just how the plot is structured that actually feels messy. Spin Out gets a 6.5 out of 10. Next one, Cloak & Dagger. I'm gonna review two seasons of it. Well, the first season of Cloak & Dagger is my absolute favorite season of the entire MCU TV show. The reason is because I actually relate them so much, and I just love how the show just focuses on character and action or superhero stuff, at least for the first season. I know it may sound odd because it's still a comic book show and I don't care much about superhero stuff more than just the character. Both Tony Bo and Tyron Johnson are flawed three-dimensional characters that has their own stuff to deal with. And Olivia Holt and Bree Johnson, great singers by the way, are wonderful in their roles. And they have insanely good chemistry with each other, and I love they just don't turn out to be romance with each other and just stick with friends, and that's great. Also, Emma Lohan as Bridget O'Reilly, not gonna make any Power Rangers references because I never watch it, has to be my most favorite MCU cop detective. Yes, even more than Misty Knight. And because of that, season 1 is my favorite because it just focuses more on character than generic superhero stuff. And then season 2, which is more on superhero stuff, which to be fair, it makes sense because at the end of season 1, they become heroes. I still really love the characters and the stuff to deal with, and also I love Mayhem, another superpower alter ego of Bridget O'Reilly, and I just love how Bridget O'Reilly and Mayhem just met and have conflict with each other, and in the end, learn to accept Mayhem. I also love the Dark Dimension stuff and the Dream stuff as well, but what drags season 2 down, it's really the villain, who wants to become god and even sex traffic girls, illegally, because he has migraines and his music career is over. Okay, for one, just because you have migraines doesn't mean that your music career is over. Just because you have a headache doesn't make you sex traffic girls. Thirdly, just because you have migraines doesn't mean you have to steal people's hope. Just go to a doctor, moron. So that's my main issue in season 2. And that's a shame because I like the actor who plays him and I do love his powers, but it's just his motivation that sucks. But I still love season 2 though. Combining the score of season 1 and season 2, Cloak & Dagger series gets a 9 out of 10. Next, The Haunting of Bly Manor. Honestly, I never thought of watching it until I heard that, oh, it's not horror, it's more romance. And then just like, yeah, okay. Just to be clear, I never watched The Haunting of Hill House. Because of that, I did not expect for me to just get like, oh, I want to get scared while watching it. The characters and acting are great. And I just love the relationship between the characters themselves. And I just love the relationship about the love inside. No matter it's friendship, love interest, toxic love, supernatural and human, and also gay relationship. Also of the theme of you don't have to be blood to be family. And those are just wonderful stuff right there. And also the supernatural elements here are just like, wow, that's surprising. I did not see that coming. And that is so interesting and I never see before. And because of her relationship and love, I just feel very emotional sometimes in the show as well. The characters and romance are the best part of the show, but the scares on the other hand. Okay, I can see some works on paper, but when you show it on screen, I can't help just like, what the fuck is that? It's so funny! Yeah, literally, I literally laughed when I see that. Also, not all supernatural things have a payoff at the end. There's an episode before the finale, which is just a delay in motion. And also, the entire show is being narrated by a person. I was just like, how do you know everything inside? There's no way. Even if someone told you everything, there's no way you can link them together and tell it as a story. Despite its issues, I still think it's a really great show. It's perfectly splendid. Giving it an 8.5 out of 10. Last, The Queen's Gambit again. After rewatching it, I kinda changed my mind. The Queen's Gambit is not the best show in 2020. It's the best thing in 2020. Well, I may be wrong because December haven't ended yet, but I doubt anything can top this. It's been a while since I saw a show that done everything right, and it just blows my mind how good this show is. And it's in a time with the worst year I've ever experienced. If you watch my review, you know that I praise the show hard in every single way, but I haven't still finished praising yet. Like how the show deals with feminism, the use of music, the foreshadowing, the reveal,
the subtle humor, and even the details of the makeup. And I still haven't praised the show enough. Not saying the show is immune to criticisms, because I still think that there are parts that I think it can be done well. But I just can't stand stupid reasoning for disliking the show. Like, there's not enough conflict, she doesn't suffer enough consequences, and she's passive. Which are bullshit, because you clearly did not pay attention to the show, and I want you to watch again and say it to my face to see are you still willing to see the same nonsense again. It's been the best thing that Netflix ever put on since the first season of Stranger Things. And it's just a show that speaks to me so much. Even in a rewatch, I tear up twice at the end. And I just have one more thing left to say towards the Queen's Gambit. But first, spoilers.
It's your game. Take it.